This design also was very good. Let me tell you that this how that 1 week is spreading out into maybe 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 LEDs is a very good plan. What I think is missing is that when you have a 1 week of content released on a MOOC, what I think it looks like, if you recall some of my slides in the orchestration dynamics thing, what we wanted to see was something like that. Okay, let me just try and open that file, but I'll just go ahead. So what happened, okay, go next now. Yeah, so what happens is that the content on MOOC should not look like this. It should not look like LED after LED after LED after LED after LED, and then activities after activities. That is to be avoided. So what we have to do is, it has to be interspersed. So it could be, I think you planned it like that, but only the presentation doesn't show it. So maybe that is the only thing. So you can have introduction to CSR as LED, followed by LBD about introduction to CSR, whatever you are going to cover. That would be the week plan or the course plan that you want to show as a MOOC creation process. So that is one thing which is very important. And the second, go to 8 number slide. Yes. So if this is the LBD, so LED1, for LED1, I think you have a LBD called as Write Two Simple Concise Definitions of CSR, which is very good, because if you go back to number 7 slide, you said that this is introduction to CSR. So you are going to introduce what is CSR, maybe a couple of definitions and all that. And after the video, if you ask this question, which is in 8, that write two simple and concise definitions of CSR, I think that will make a lot of sense. So you can see that people have understood something, and then learning by doing has happened. But what I feel is that for LED4, what will be the LED4? Can you see the slide 7? Yeah, planning for CSR. Now, without actually having a lot of other information, it's just 4 lecture old learner you are talking to. And lectures are LEDs which are small, like 10-minute, 15-minute LED. So within 1 hour of session, that what you have given to them, you are actually asking them to prepare a detailed CSR plan for one manufacturing company and one service company. Now, preparing two plans after just 40 minutes of interaction with the person looks too daunting to me. We can, so this one is quite good, like identify area of businesses which demonstrate the significance of CSR. This is like, you can apply your mind, because you must have seen some case studies in the videos, and everything is fine. But I think the creation of a detailed CSR plan or creation of detailed template, these are kind of end of course activities. Like after they have gone through the entire course, probably they would be able to imagine this kind of thing, because they must be at least 7-8 hour content they have consumed. They have spent 7-8 hours on doing smaller activities or interacting with students or interacting with teachers. And then you can expect them that, okay, they have created a plan. Do you agree with me or?
Yes, sir, yes. You are right. But if it is just template, maybe they do, but detailed plan, probably they will need more.
Yeah, my intention was that, okay, based on, so you can identify what are the similar aspects of a template after you go through the lecture on various CSR templates. So that is fine, because then they would be able to compare the templates and then come up with the commonalities. That is okay as a beginner level thing, that when you are just entering the course.
So right. That is one. Can you categorize different types of different types of plans?
Yes, yes. So list, categorize, compare, this kind of action verbs are fine for the LBD activities. But prepare, design, these are higher order thinking things which come at the end of the thing. That is what my point was. Okay, now go to 9 or 10, where you have LED reflection spots. Yeah, so this is the this is the problem which is carry forwarded from yesterday's presentation also with what we had seen in Sandeep Sharma's thing. So the reflection spots are sitting outside the LEDs, outside the videos or outside the content. That is kind of, I am assuming that reflection spots should be, you have thought of it as a part of your video, but it is not presented in that manner. So what I assume is that when you say introduction to CSR as a lecture, maybe in between when you give, or like history of CSR, so in that lecture you can pause for a point and say what prompted governments across the world to focus on CSR, and then based on your lecture so far, the learners will be able to reflect upon saying that, okay, this could be ABC reasons. And I have said that earlier and I repeat myself, which is your slide number 12. Yes, the answer could be, should be more than 5 options should be available for any question that you post in reflection spot. The reflections have to be different. It cannot be a single correct answer question. It should not be single correct answer question. So what are top 3 companies? So obviously people will Google and give you answer. So that is not reflection. That is just recall or by hearting something, or just look for data, look up for data and spit out the answer. So that should not be the thing. Question should be something which will have multiple possibilities of answers. So this kind of question design within the script of a LED is what we are expecting here. So I think that has gone slightly off in this presentation, but rest of the LXTs are quite good, very well thought of reading material. Again, the same comment which I gave yesterday, LXTs need not be chunked into videos and ebooks and this thing, but they should be chunked by topics. They should be saying that, okay, if you want to know various portals from where you will get information about CSR, then you can go to this. Again, Ministry of Commerce and Industry is a huge website, and various avenues for CSR is only one page out of it. So don't give the entire commerce.gov.in, because they will go to tenders and they will go to who is the minister and all that. Do you want them to go haywire into reading this? Go very specific, and the label should be very inviting and self-explanatory rather than list of resources. So list of resources is a very, 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 very broad sentence. So rather than that, you can say that portals or resources for learning more about CSR funding availability, and then give everything there. There could be videos, papers, websites, everything else. But history of CSR, then give. So that would be interesting. Models of CSR, yes. So if you have management models of CSR as a video also, in some, by somebody, some other author, then all these things should be clubbed within a label called as management models of CSR, and then give a ebook, give a video, give a website, whatever. So this is what I think I have inputs about, and yes, some inspire. So case studies. So that is fine. The CSR initiatives of Tata, Mahindra, PNG, all that. So that those could be just a list of case studies or inspiring initiatives or something like that. So that should be the label. So focus on the label rather than the type of media. That was the suggestion.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, President.
Yes.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yes. So we are going to the law now, right?
Hello, sir. Sir, Arpita will be presenting on behalf of a School of Law.
Okay. And who is the timekeeper now?
I think the School of Hospitality is the next.
Yeah. Anyone from their department? You can share the screen by the time we get the person.
Yes, sir. We are here, sir.
Okay. Can you do this?
I hope I'm visible. My slide is visible and I'm audible to everyone.
Yeah, it is visible.
All right, thank you. So I'm Arpita Yadav and I'll be presenting on behalf of the School of Law. We have chosen the topic.
Your audio is very low. Can you?
Yes, sir. Is it fine now?
Yeah, better.
Yeah. So we have chosen the topic of constitutional remedies for a MOOC that we'll be creating. And these are my team members. They are my co-presenters who would be present, would be teaching the MOOC. The objective of our MOOC is to make available the remedies so that even a layman can understand they have certain fundamental rights that are guaranteed by the Constitution, and in case there is an infringement of a fundamental right, like if their personal freedom is infringed, then they should know about the remedies that are available to them. So our target audience is not only the law students, the law teachers, but anyone who would be interested in the constitutional studies, and we'll be designing it in a way that not only the persons from legal background, but also the laymen also able to understand the basics of the constitutional remedies. This is our week-wise plan. In the week one, we'll be dealing with the basic introduction, meaning and scope of the constitutional remedies, what are rates, what are the scope of Article 32 and Article 226 under the Constitution, and the weekly feedback we'll be having there. Then in the second week, we'll be specifically dealing with a writ of habeas corpus, its meaning and scope, the essential components, challenges and way forward, and ultimately the weekly feedback on it. Similarly, in week three, we'll be dealing with a specific writ of quo warranto, its meaning and early history, modern use of quo warranto, and nature of its remedy, and what are the conditions that are necessary for the issuance of a writ of quo warranto by the Supreme Court or the High Court, respectively. Then in week four, we have a specific writ of prohibition, its meaning and scope, essential components, and the contemporary scenario. In week five, we have mandamus, how it has developed, its meaning, and what is its significance in the administrative actions, and what are the current approaches that the courts have taken up while addressing the issue of writ of mandamus. Then in week six, we have specific writ of certiorari, its basic introduction, history and scope, and some of the landmark judgments that are associated with the writ of certiorari. And in the last week, we'll have the concept of public interest litigation, how it has transformed over the years, and we'll also read about some of the landmark judgments that have helped in the social legal transformation of the country. In this, this is some sample of the week-wise presentation. Just one minute. This is just a sample of the week-wise presentation. So for week one, that deals with the introduction, meaning and scope of the constitutional remedies, we have these many topics that are planned. Then week two, similarly, and week three. In this particular presentation, we'll be dealing with week two specifically, that is the writ of habeas corpus. And even in that particular topic, we have chosen a heading of meaning and scope for our LEDs. So these are the breakpoints of the meaning of habeas corpus, the brief history, and what is the scope of the writ of habeas corpus. This would be the flow of how I'll be teaching habeas corpus as to what is its meaning. Is it a writ for personal freedom, for ensuring personal freedom? Is it a fundamental right that is available to the individuals? Who can specifically apply for this writ, and the overall scope? Then the writ of habeas corpus, as some of you would know, has been derived from the Latin term that means to have the body. So it is basically a judicial remedy that is available to the citizens as well as non-citizens of this particular country to approach the Supreme Court and the High Court specifically if they have been illegally detained by the authorities. So this has been a reflection spot that I've created, that who can apply for the writ of habeas corpus. The answer is here. These many people, the person or the prisoner himself who has been legally detained can write letters or postcards to the judges of the Supreme Court and the High Court. That will be treated as a valid application for the writ of habeas corpus. If he's not able to approach the judicial authorities, then anybody on his behalf, be it the friends, family, relatives, anybody can file. They can also appoint an advocate who would file for a writ. Then even any NGO or a public-spirited person can also file for a writ of habeas corpus if they know that a person has been illegally detained. I got a feedback on this particular reflection spot that you also have to give the negative answer. So this is the negative answer for it, that who cannot apply for a writ of habeas corpus. So any person who has been legally detained under a law with all the procedural compliances cannot approach the Supreme Court or the High Court for the writ of habeas corpus. They can apply for bail, but they have no remedy under the writ jurisdiction of the courts. Then this is the second reflection spot that I've created here. That can writ of habeas corpus be issued against a private person? So the answer is yes. And this is the detailed answer of it, that it's not only the public authorities, that could be the police or any agency who has been authorized to detain a particular person, but even a private person or a non-public authority can be summoned by the Supreme Court or the High Court while deciding on the factor of writ of habeas corpus. Recent case has been wherein a madrasa teacher had been summoned to illegally detain a Muslim woman in his madrasa. That was a non-public authority. Then we have some LBDs. The first type is the MCQ, that is recall and understand level questions. So we have this question here. We have the detailed answer or the customized feedback here, that all of the scenarios are all of these persons can file for the writ of habeas corpus. The curious point here is option number C, that illegal detention during emergency, because this has been a moot point, wherein the infamous judgment of the Supreme Court in ADM Jabalpur versus Shrikant Shukla held that they do not have a right to apply for writ of habeas corpus in cases of emergency, in national emergency, but the parliament amended it through the 44th amendment and passed this amendment and established that rights under Article 21 and 22 cannot be suspended even during the proclamation of emergency. So this is the customized.
Yeah, yeah. Sorry. You can skip the details. But yeah, very well written. We'll go ahead. Yeah.
So this is the second type of LBD that created that state the circumstances when a writ of habeas corpus can be refused, because by the time this time learners would know when the habeas corpus can be refused by the court. So these are the circumstances when the writ of habeas corpus can be refused by the courts. Then we have a third type of LBD, that is activity requiring integration of the concepts, wherein we'll give them some case studies and they'll have to answer as to whether habeas corpus would be applied to this particular case study or not. This is the LXT. These are some of the links that I've provided. And based on these links, I have the assimilation quiz. And the second type of resource that I want them to know is the format of filing a writ petition in Supreme Courts and High Courts. So this is something new here. And this is another type of assimilation quiz that they have. So this is all about our MOOC for week 3 particularly. I will welcome all the feedbacks on this presentation. Thank you.
Okay. I should say that in the presentation so far, this is the most comprehensive presentation, which is according to the format of how learner-centric MOOC can be planned. This is pretty much nearer to the formatting, and I will take a bit of time maybe in explaining what is missing in other presentations, because it is available there in bits of pieces, or sometimes it is available in a sporadic manner, but this has almost all ticks passed here. We will comment about some parts which are not really, maybe not, I don't know, I'm not getting the right word. You have followed the template part correctly, and the content is, you are pretty confident about the content. So that is also not a problem. Chunking is perfect. You have placed week-wise structure also in a proper manner. The only problem I have is, and I need to share my screen for that. So can you allow me to do that for a minute? I'll take over your screen. Can you see this? Hello, can you see this?
Yes, sir.
So when you had thought of a learning dialogue, I think you had written a title about like what is this particular concept or something. There was a nice title about a learning dialogue. What was missing is that, at least you explained other things in an elaborate manner, like every constructive feedback also you had written down all the 4 or 5 lines of constructive feedback, and it was very nice to see that. But what was missing, which I could not see on the slide, was this part. So there was some content. There should be some content in the learning dialogue to begin with. Now you should start speaking about something first of all. Once you start, in between somewhere you have to ask a reflection spot question. So when, and then there should be another chunk of content which will summarize everything else. What I saw in your presentation was the name of the LED, like this is my learning dialogue number one, and this is the title of the learning dialogue, and then directly I saw the reflection spot. This was the only missing link. There was because I think the way we have shown on the slide is also because of that. Like we have shown an example of reflection spot also looks like, okay, so this is the question directly. What you cannot see here is the content before this. But let me tell you that this one is probably slide number 5 or something. So there are 4 slides of explanation before this, which talks about collaboration and peer learning, what is the fundamental idea behind it, how it has evolved, or whatever the explanation could be. And once that is done, then and only then you can have a reflection spot after that. But in your case, I could not find that particular thing. So maybe the sentence which I'm using is correct, that I could not find, and you have it in mind, but I could not see that. And therefore, this diagram, which we have repeated multiple times in our presentation, always talks about content followed by reflection spot, again followed by content. So now if I stop my presentation, and I request you to share your slides, then I can actually pinpoint what I'm trying to say.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so if you go to your LED,
yes,
week one LED, yeah, okay. So this is the title. That was correct.
Yes, this is.
Yes. So, yeah. So this one is, according to you, is the meaning of habeas corpus, and what is that? It is a Latin term to have body, and who can order for the release of prisoner. That is what you are explaining, right? Now, the second slide is. The next slide is who can apply. Now the here is another fundamental principle that I need to. We cannot ask a reflection spot on something which has not been taught in the class. So, for example, when we say that Newton's laws of motion is the lecture today, we cannot ask in the class that what is Newton's first law of motion? Are you have not taught? We have come here to learn that only, and you are asking us only to say that. That will be the reaction. So we have to avoid asking that question, because with this much information, like slide number 11, it is not clear who can apply for the writ, right? That question is not explained here. If you if you do that part, probably here you can click on 11 now and see. So they can only order, but who can apply is not explained here. So you have not touched that condition at all. And then the question comes up on 12th slide that, okay, now who can apply? So the only answer can be given is by general knowledge. This is not a reflection. Are you getting the point?
Yes, sir. I'll keep that in
mind. Right. So we cannot ask a question based on the general knowledge, which we have not taught. So we have to have a methodology. So you are after reflection spot. So go to reflection spot. Okay. Then you had this answer. Who can apply? Right. You gave the answers. Right. Actually, reflection spot could be, now that you know who all can apply, can you think of who all cannot apply for this? That would be something that they don't know definitely, but that they will be able to at least think about it. Like, okay, maybe who cannot apply, maybe so some of them can at least think of an answer that maybe somebody who is already having a charge on them, or person who is directly beneficiary, or some such answers will come up there. I don't know really what answers can be given there, but there will be some scope of reflection happening there. That was the only missing link in the entire presentation. But otherwise, this is some template that everyone should definitely look at. Try to talk to this team about what all is done here, because only then others will be able to understand what all is not there in their own presentation, probably. I'm really happy to see this presentation, because it has each and every aspect covered in a very nice manner. In fact, if you go next, the LBDs are good. So this one, LBD is good. What is the LBD? Under what circumstances can person file? So this is very nice MCQ. Go next. Yeah, feedback is okay. Option A is correct, but not most appropriate answer. Is not constructive feedback. It is only customized feedback, because you have seen A is not the correct. But we have to explain like why it is not most appropriate, and how do you define appropriate, most appropriate, and less appropriate. So this question mark will be there. You have to say that, okay, elaborate on something like that, because this does not have elaboration about this. Like, what is the option A? Just show me that in 18. Illegal detention by police officer. Now, it is not most appropriate. Like, why there is a problem? So you have to explain that.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And then it will be fine. But very well attempted part. Okay, go next. State circumstances, okay. This is good. Go next. Okay, this is okay. Then LXT is also, I think you can go to LXT, week one LXT. Okay. Resources for trajectory one. What you have not done in the presentation is that you have not given the label of the trajectory in a big font. You should say trajectory one is application of habeas corpus. That is our trajectory, and then these are the resources. So that is hidden, because the resources word is bold, but the main trajectory word is not bold. So people will not be able to see that. And web links and documents is another bold thing, which is the common mistake that people have done in the presentations that I saw yesterday and today. So you can explain that better way by saying that name of our trajectory one is application of habeas corpus. So anyone who wants to know about application of habeas corpus should go to these things. Again, please make sure the sentence that was later yesterday, you cannot outsource your teaching to LXTs. So if this is part of this, so you have to explicitly mention what this YouTube video will have different than the content that you were trying to explain. If it is application of habeas corpus in XYZ context, then you have to mention that. Now, that is not part of your curriculum, but you are just wanting them to know about it. So you mention that. Only then it will have value. Otherwise, just youtube.com/watch?v=KV. That has no meaning absolutely. And that is very difficult too. So that explanation is what we are looking at. We are not looking at whether you have found out a web link or not. So that is the suggestion. But all in all, you have followed the template almost, the following of template has been done almost up to 85 to 90%, which is a very good thing. And there are errors in the understanding probably, but that can be fixed very easily. But a very good job all in all. All those who have worked on this should be really thanked for this. Good job.
Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you so much.
Yes, let's go to hospitality.
Good evening, sir.
Yes. I so wonder that because I was almost speechless for the questions raised in the law MOOC that I could not even pronounce probably half of the words, forget about answering them. So it was pretty tough for me to evaluate that. I hope hospitality should be kind of interesting.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Who is the timekeeper?
Just a minute.
Next batch from the School of Business, Dr. Richa, Dr. Kanu, you know.
Okay. So they will keep the time?
Okay, sir, we will. 10 minutes now.
12 minutes for the presentation and 10 minutes is the tring tring and 12 minutes for the time,
yes.
Time out.
Yes, yes.
I'm unable to display this presentation. Bimal sir, can you help me out? Because there's some new feature in Google Meet, so I am unable to display this presentation. So I've opened this presentation, right?
Yes, sir.
No. Didn't know.
You so just shared window, a second back you are sharing the screen.
Window or tab?
Window. If you have PowerPoint presentation, go to window.
No, it's visual. Is it visible, sir?
Yes.
Yes, sir, just coming up.
Yeah.
So, very good evening, sir. And on behalf of School of Hospitality, I, Dilip Kumar, along with Mr. Bimal Shukla, would like to present this introduction to innovation in hospitality. Although we are going to present this, but whole team worked together and we sat together and we prepared this presentation. So this first slide, the topics which we are going to cover in week number one, that is, what is innovation? Innovation versus invention. Because these two are very similar type of word, and there's a very thin line between innovation and invention. Why innovation? Need for innovation? Types of innovation? And last one, that is the application of innovation in hospitality and tourism. So we are going to cover these six topics in week one. So before planning this thing, we circulated that survey form, we prepared that survey form, and as per the survey form, we tried to find out the types of learner which for which we are going to prepare this presentation or for which we are going to prepare this MOOC course. So this is a link which we prepared. Now, after this, we planned our work, and the first topic, that is, what is innovation? So as it is derived from a Latin word, that is innovare, which means to renew. Innovation means to improve or to replace something. So whatever thing is there already existing, so we have to renew it, that we have to update that. Because if we have to survive, we must have to keep renewing, keep updating the things. So as per Peter F. Drucker, innovation is a specific tool of entrepreneurs, the means by which they exploit changes as an opportunity for a different business or a different service. So if we will not keep updating ourselves, we won't be able to survive in this world. So the next part of this, that is, what is the difference between innovation and invention? As I told you earlier, that's a very thin line. So innovation means creation of a product or introduction of a process for the first time. The first time, like Thomas Alva Edison discovered the world. So what was that? Did Thomas Alva Edison discover the bulb first time? Means before that, there was no such thing like bulb. But innovation, bit different. Innovation happens when someone improves or makes a significant contribution. So whatever thing is there, and if some changes is required, or if some changes done there, and then something new innovated from that, new idea came out from that, so that is what is innovation. So something that has already been invented, an existing product, process or service. So very good example, that is Steve Jobs was an inventor. So these are two means YouTube link, YouTube video, which more explains about what is invention and what is innovation. So participants, you must have to go through these two videos, and you must means clear much more doubt about innovation and invention if you have. Now, before moving ahead, let me tell you why innovation is required. As we have discussed invention, innovation, or the next topic, innovation, why it is required? Is it really required? Or whatever thing is there, we can survive in that. That is more than enough for our survival. So, yeah, some points are there. Why innovation? Like, it helps in economic growth. It also creates future jobs. It also creates, means increase the well-being, reduce sickness, promote poverty, hunger, communication and educational accessibility. Very good example. Yeah, means before the starting of this COVID, so we all were doing that offline thing, classroom lecture. So we were not aware that if something will happen, how we can do that. So certainly that offline mode converted into online mode. So we started to find out the best way to conduct a lecture, to conduct a class. Some people tried opted that Zoom class, some opted Google Meet, some opted Microsoft. So that is nothing. This is called as innovation. Innovation. Environmental sustainability, increased productivity. So these are some of the importance. These are some of the means importance of innovation, and that's why the innovation is really required. I hope the whatever things I have explained till now is much more clear for you. So before moving ahead, let's clear your doubt, or let me know how much you have understood. This is the reflection spot in the form of true or false. Is invention and innovation are same? Innovation takes place due to general changes only. So these two are reflection spot before moving ahead. So this is the types of innovation. Although the picture clarity is not very good, we tried to find out. This is little informal. I will not going to say such thing in the class, but I'm telling it right now. The picture quality is not very good, but we found it much more relevant. So that's why we have added this picture here, because innovation, types of innovation, product innovation, process innovation. Like product innovation, when you talk like new product innovation, new source of supply, new methods of reproduction, so, and again, process innovation, this is the, these are some of the types of innovation. Importance of innovation. We studied about what is innovation, why innovation is required, what is the difference between innovation and invention. Now we are talking about importance of innovation. Is there any importance of innovation? Yes, it has lots of importance. Like it helps in creating development. Creative development, yeah. Responding to competition and trends. It also helps in continuous improvement, making the most of what you have already. But that's why innovation is required. Having a unique selling point, the use of social media. So through this, through innovation, if we really like to move ahead, if we want to be wondered, so certainly there's a requirement of innovation, and these are some of the importance of innovation. So before moving ahead, again, a reflection spark in the form of true or false. So marketing innovation is a type of innovation in hospitality industry. Does innovation helps an organization to reaching to creative development? So these are two reflection spots which we have prepared before moving ahead. So these are some of the things about our
lesson. I think this content is very nicely composed about innovation and the importance of innovation. So that is coming out nicely. The point I wanted to see was that, so if this is going to be your MOOC structure, because have you estimated like how much time are you going to devote to this entire week of content? Is it going to be 1 hour or 2 hours, or how many such videos are going to be uploaded there?
So we have planned it for 1 week, sir. And 1 week means 2 hours, 4 hours class.
1 week means 2 hours or two
four
and a half hours. 4 hours, okay.
Four hours.
So 4 hours of content, yeah. So now the what is needed is that if you plan for 4 hours, you have to also identify how you are going to split that 4 hours. How much of that part is going to be generated in terms of videos, or there are some activities going to be there, or some reading material is going to be provided, or some assessment is going to happen, or some discussions are going to happen. So 4 hours cannot be a video lecture or a live session of 4 hours. So 4 hours is going to be offline activity. People are not going to be in front of you when you are doing this. This is not going to be a Zoom session. So I am not an expert on the topic, so I may not be able to appreciate the structure of like whether the slide will require this slide of importance of hospitality industry will have about better guest connection or training and development of staff. Whether these bullets are right or wrong is out of scope for me, because I'm not from that industry. So I really apologize for that, because I don't know how to comment on that. But what I want to see in this as a maybe valedictory of this particular workshop that we conducted for a couple of weeks back is, do you have a structure of your MOOC? Like you saw in the earlier presentation, when they said that, okay, we have a learning unit one, like the week one, we'll have 4 LEDs, which will be 4 videos of 10 minutes each. And then each video will have an activity after that. And this will be the question, or this will be the activity that they need to do. And then they need to get some answers about it, and then they'll progress. So like you saw in the first presentation also, that they will say that, okay, now we have given a lecture about various models of CSR. Now the activity is that compare 2 models or 3 models and submit your response to that. Or what do you find unique in the following models that we have given? Or what are the similar factors in this model? Because we have explained models to them, we can ask them to do some activity on that. So that is what is a structure of the course, which is going to be a offline course, not an online course. So I think what I find very nice is that you have tried to incorporate the reflection spot theory quite nicely. You have come up with nice questions about it. But again, I am afraid, but these things will work in a live class much better. You have created a structure which is a very good structure for a live class. Like if you are giving a lecture in a class and you pause the video or pause your lecture and ask the question like you had the reflection spot, I think that will fly very well. The questions are very nicely done. You will get response also very nicely. The engagement will be very high when you do this thing. But what we are looking at it is a MOOC structure right now. So I think you need to get into a meeting with a couple of other teams probably to just get to maybe reform your list of content into a MOOC structure is what I think right now.
Sir, we have also prepared LVD, we have also prepared LXD
okay,
and LXI.
Okay. Ah, great, great. So you can just show that. Yeah, that's fine. Because again, as I said, this is a comment to everyone. See, we none of us from the LCM team are experts on the topics that you are presenting. So we will not be able to appreciate the subject expertise. So avoid the lecture part. You can just say that, okay, this is my topic.
So this is the rehearsal of learning dialogues. And
okay.
This is about LPD. Bimal sir.
Thank you, Dilip sir. I hope I'm audible.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes. So now moving to the next segment in LBD, based on the topic, ours is primarily is more theory oriented and is based on knowledge impartment. So the LBD is also designed around the same concept. In the first topic, what is innovation, we'll be showing a couple of videos and touching upon various aspects of innovation happening or taking place in the hospitality and tourism domain. And there will be some questions and it will be done in a structured manner following the video. Next, please, Dilip. In the next topic, innovation versus invention, we will ask the candidates or participants to search for some examples of both, ideally two, belonging to innovation as well as invention.
Yeah, this
and
is good.
Then come up with their reasoning for this.
Correct.
All right, sir. Thank you. So then we will be doing why innovate. We will be doing a quiz which will be true and false based, and this will also be following. This will be also following the detailed feedback. In addition to the answers, we will also be telling them why, and we will also be attaching some level of theory knowledge to it.
Yeah, that next, looks good.
Yes, next part, Dilip
sir. Yes, sir. Just a minute.
Yeah. No problem, sir. So in our last part, in the application of innovation.
This is also nice.
Yes, sir. We will be doing an MCQ quiz because the options will be more varied and diverse. And okay. We have to look for this option, sir. So this is from my side.
This is LBD,
yeah.
Sir.
So the,
yes.
Okay.
Yes, Dilip sir, what do you say?
Yeah. Yes. Thank you, sir. So we have also prepared LXT and LXI, sir. So with your permission, may I present, sir? This is LXT. So LXT means the clear-cut instructions will be given to them, like the participants are requested to go through the link provided. Graded estimation quiz will be conducted on the basis of the same. One question from every content, go through the abstract and findings carefully. There will be total 5 graded questions. So the instruction will be given to them well in advance. The link, this is the video URL link. And we after this, the 5 research papers are there along with the link and all. So the participant has to go through all these things. And they, as the instruction, as you have also recommended earlier, that you have to give them clear cut instruction, like whether they have to go through full paper or they have to go through abstract or finding. So the same message is conveyed to them. So these are some of the reading material. After this, assimilation quiz. So as the five questions, the portions are also there along with the options and all. So even which of the following, which are not a sensual note of hospitality according to authors. So the author name and all. So all these are given. So the answer which is in green means the option which is in green, that is the real means the true one.
This is good. This is good. So you have given in bracket about which paper we are talking about.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Sir. Okay, great. This looks good.
So again, the same
yeah.
thing.
Sir. So this is fine. This is fine. I think you have got the point here. Yeah, 12 minutes over. So yeah. That's fine. I think we. But yeah, because I intruded in between, we will continue. I think you have perfectly got the point of LXT. That is very nice to see how you have thought of an LXT. So suggestion to all the groups, like when you say that you are going this paper to read and then you are going to ask the quiz, this is good enough for today's presentation. I don't want you to read the paper for me here. Similarly, when you are saying that we are going to have a LED on something like this and then we are going to have a reflection spot, I don't want you to present that entire LED of 15 minutes in front of me right now, because it will be not only wasting the time, but it is beyond my capacity to comprehend. So that is where the problem happened. So I think when you started explaining the entire LED as how you are going to give the lecture, then I had a doubt in between that whether you have the other plans in place or not. So that is why I just stopped it. But I think what you have got here is very nice. I think all other teams should look at the way they have designed the assimilation quizzes. I think they have done a very good job of this part. Only suggestion I would have is...
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. This question is from video. So
that's okay. But the point is that you have not written that it is based on this video. And another missing link, yeah. Another missing part is that the video, what is in the video is not explained there. It's just again same thing, youtube.com/whatever. So we need whatever, but we cannot just give a URL. The point should be, why should people look at that video? That should be explained somewhere. So if you look at our VLE also, when we give VLE, let me share my screen to make the point clearer. I'm just going to share my screen now. Okay, can you see VLE?
Shall I stop presenting, sir?
Yeah.
We can see, sir.
Just a minute.
Okay, so here in the DLC MOOC, if you see resources, right? So we have said that because we did not have an option of adding LXT here, we have just made a page called as assignment here. In assignment, if you see, if you go to the page, you will see that we have written, watch this LED title about this, what is learning by doing activity, and then you can watch this LED from this minute to this minute. So it is mentioned here. Then about how to create LBD, there are some explanation given that type of LBD can be based on A, B and B. And then you can watch creating LBDs as a video. So we could have just given video 1, video 2, but we have not done that. We have, or even diving deeper. So there are constructive feedback has to be given. For details on how to give constructive feedback, watch video 1, 2 and 3. So similarly, we have tried to give in additional resources, the following video explains about how to align assessment to learning objectives using revised Bloom taxonomy, and then we have given the video. So that is where I think it should happen in this manner, so that the learners are clear about why we are watching this particular thing. Is it okay?
Right, sir.
Okay. Okay, so good hospitality team. I think there are a couple LXI, of good takeaways. So what is the LXI? Okay.
So if you permit, sir, I can again discuss.
Yeah. Go ahead.
This is LXI, sir. Learning experience interaction. So we have prepared the focus question again. Like we can ask the participant, like introduce yourself and tell us where you have spotted innovations in hospitality industry, which had proved to be a path-breaking in creating guest delight. So again, the focus question. Also,
very nice. Dialogue. Very, very interesting question. We'll surely get a lot of responses for this.
Yes, sir. So also adding motivation or drive for joining this course. So why you have enrolled yourself in this course? Again, then after this, the question discussion thread. So any innovation that you have seen here or experienced abroad, which is yet to be adopted in India. So again, this is the thread question discussion thread. State the type of innovation. Draw 3 points in which they provide you to important. They try to be important either to the industry or in providing guest satisfaction. Identify its unique selling point. Identify the challenges in or why adopting these innovations. So this is discussion thread, and this is the final thing, that is a reflection spot. Small teaser of the coming topic and posing a question at food for thought. The 3 takeaways from the week session. Comment on any 2 of the peers' response. And the instructor randomly may give the forum and comment on some responses provided by the students.
Yes, I think, yeah. I don't know whether this can be a reflection spot, but yes, I think your LXI questions were quite interesting, and they will definitely generate a lot of interaction within the students who are going to be there. So I think that is a very well thought idea. Good. Thanks.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you, sir. And thank you, team, also.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Can we go to the next one?
Sure, sir. Yes.
Who is going to present?
So this is Dr. Dhana Singh Rathaur. Dr. Richa, that is myself, Ms. Indrani Singh Gupta, and Dr. Tanu.
Okay.
Just a minute, I will present.
Yeah, ma'am, I'm here. Yeah, it is visible now.
Okay.
Thank you, ma'am. So good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. So we have prepared our first MOOC. We have tried. Okay. So we definitely will be needing your suggestions wherever you think that, you know, we are going wrong. And as you have suggested us that, you know, you should go with some topic which you are a lot of familiar with. We thought, let us try something which is new to us, because if we try with a hard one, it will be easy later on, because we have experts right now with us. They can guide us in the harder topics. So then later it will be easy for us to go with the topics which we are familiar. So we started with blockchain and industry 4.0 and blockchain. And the topic of our MOOC is fundamentals of industry 4.0 and blockchain. So this is our course auditing. As you can see, the session topic and the major MOOC topic, then the duration, the objective, and the participation of the student. So that is the course auditing. So the first topic of LED, what we did is that the content chunking part was there. So we thought that, first of all, when we are delivering the first class, the student should know what exactly is Industry 4.0 and what is blockchain. So first of all, we started with making the first part, that is the first topic of LED, that is introduction of Industry 4.0 and meaning of blockchain, which we have one or two sample slides also we have shown in our PPT, and also a script we have, which ma'am, please click the script. So script is like detailed version of, what our slide talks about. So we it is not, totally very precise and very systematic, but we have tried it.
It is not visible, I think, because I need to change the screen. So let me
at the end we'll show the
we have already slide. Submitted it to
yes, sir. Yes, yes. So yeah. You can change the slide, ma'am.
Yeah,
so this is our what is introduction to industry 4.0. so this is the PPT. The script covers the descriptive of the PPT. Next slide, please. So after telling the student that what is industry 4.0, then we will be the next part will be the reflection spot, where do you think your data is secured when it comes to industry 4.0. and then we will explain the, so in that reflection point, what we will do is there will be a Google form thing, that wherein they, the student can give his idea about what he thinks about this particular topic. So it's just a small gist that after one topic explanation, small topic, that was the reflection spot. Then again we will explain what the blockchain, the definition, and what exactly the blockchain is. And after that we'll be doing LBD activity 1. Again, the slides which we have shown in the definition of blockchain and industry 4.0, that is just a part of it. The whole script is, we have written for that, the same. So in LBD, we have like two topics. Let's discuss. Is there any interrelationship between industry 4.0 and blockchain, and importance of blockchain and in industry 4.0? Next slide, please. So again, on the LBD, there's a reflection spot. So we were like little confused that whether if we can give a poll pop-up or we can give a assignment using Google form. So we weren't pretty sure about it, because how it is going to be. So we have just given this option that after the LBD that we have discussed, the student has thought on what is the relationship between the two, and then this reflection spots comes in again. Yeah, please, next slide. Yeah, then we have, this is LXTs, that is we have given topic wise some videos for student to refer that how industry uses blockchain technology. That is a YouTube video, and then industry 4.0 and the phenomena of this disruptive technology. So basically we are again getting the student will have a little bit more idea about what we have explained them in the class.
This will be an extra reading
for them. That is LXTs. Next slide, ma'am. So again, after that, the reference books, we have given some for students to understand. Then there are research papers on blockchain and industry 4.0, because research is again a very good way of understanding a topic, because you see that what other have found out new on that. So that's why we have, because instead of giving newspaper articles and all those things, we have thought that research paper will be better way of letting the students or the participants understand more about the topic and the work being done on this, because this is now the new thing which is gaining rapid advancement and rapid acceptance in the industry 4.0. Then later on after that, we'll be taking feedback of the LED one, wherein we will provide a Google form on the Likert scale to the participants, which will be and a little bit of few open-ended question on which we can, you know, understand that how much the student have or the participant had understood from the particular LED which we have given to them with different methodologies.
So this one we have not attached over here right now, like it is a sort of work in progress, but this sort of thing we have in mind right now.
Then we have again gone to LED 2. I mean, like, we are just giving example. Even LED 1 and 2 are not covering our whole week, because our first week is going to be like, you know, basic idea of, but then we have just covered two LEDs for a specimen of how we were thinking of planning it. So the history of Industry 4.0 and blockchain, again, it is a 15 minutes of video lecture with script draft we have already submitted. So this is the, you know, one slide, demo slide of the whole history of Industry 4.0 and blockchain with some sample, you know, pictures, how it is, how we can show. Then we have given some, you know, after explaining, I mean, if once the participant has seen the whole video of the simulation, Industry 4.0 and blockchain, so then we will give them assimilation questions. That is a fun trivia of 3 minutes that, you know, different question based on what he has seen are in video, in our videos, and what he has seen in the material. Not exactly in the material, the trivia ka question is already covered in the PPTs and script which we have given to the students. So even if they don't see the video, or maybe, you know, they alternate or they skip some part, still they will be able to answer the trivia. Then again, LBD, so there is an activity wherein the student is supposed to prepare a proposal of how he is going to launch, when we talk about Industry 4.0. So if they want to have a blockchain technology within its industry, so if he has to prepare a proposal wherein, you know, he can use these bullet points to prepare the proposal, like type of company and industry which it belongs, technology, availability, and the budget of the company. Because budget, whenever you are having an IT configuration into your industry, you have to think of a company, you have to think upon that, you know, what is your budget. Then virtual machine, nodes, algorithms, IoT, and machine learning relevance. So all these are certain factors which we are like giving it to student that, you know, to prepare that proposal. Because ours is not total technical or IT part of blockchain and industry point of view, 4.0. Our point of view is more related to the business business management, the commercial part of it. So our proposal, our activity is also like that only. So we are just guiding the student to use the creative part of their side. And based on the this LBD, next slide please, we are given again a reflection spot on LBD, that is assignment, which will be graded again, and the submission of proposal by the student, that will be again 20 marks. And herein we would also, maybe so you can, you know, later on tell us that can we give this kind of, you know, option in the MOOC that, you know, until you submit this assignment, you will not be able to go to the next part of the MOOC. So that's the question which we are posting from our team to you, which you can, you know, let us know after we submit, finish our presentation. And then on the same assignment which the student has submitted, we are just using the terminology VLE, because we have VLE, our own university's platform. So the faculty will also be submitting, giving a suggestion, feedback, and marks on VLE itself. Next slide, please. Then again, LXTs we have given on the same LBD2, that is history of blockchain and application of blockchain in Industry 4.0 via some YouTube videos. Next slide, ma'am. Then again, the feedback from the student will be providing again a Google form to the participants, which will be Likert based and open-ended question again, whether they have understood from our videos and the material which we have provided, and their kind of, you know, feedback. So that is it from our side. We have just, touched upon that how we have understood the whole MOOCs thing and your suggestions and recommendations for the same, sir.
Okay, so that was quite exhaustive, I should say, because you had done multiple options in the given time. Can you go back a couple of slides? So one of the common points which I saw, that I think there is a people are using this idea of reflection spot. So this slide. So reflection spot on LBD is something I think is a nomenclature problem. I think what you want to do is that you wanted some interaction about that. So that is how you are you have added the word reflection spot there. But you know, next slide. So this one is not a, yeah, this is a reflection about what they have done, but yeah, maybe it is not matching with my definition of what is a reflection spot, because my definition of reflection spot is whenever you are giving a video lecture and it is becoming a monologue, then you just pause the video by asking a question, and this particular action is called as a reflection spot in the definition that we have asked. Yeah, you have raised a hand.
Yeah, sir. So we have between in the video itself only. Richa ma'am, if you can push back towards slide one and slide two of the.
Yeah, that is correct. What you have done in the video is perfectly fine. I am just saying that this thing. So in my definition, reflection spot doesn't exist in a LBD. So because you wrote reflection spot in
LBD. Even we were confused on this, sir. When we were preparing.
Yeah, that is
what. Wait. We have played safe. We have kept reflection spot everywhere.
Extra so safe, I suppose. Okay, go to fly slide number five. Go to slide number five.
हमने सोचा समीर सर से पूछेंगे कि समीर सर, हमने हर जगह रख दिया है, बताओ सही कहाँ पे है?
वो रखते हैं, बाकी हटा देते हैं. ठीक है. ओके, एक प्रॉब्लम हो रही है रिफ्लेक्शन स्पॉट के समझने में. दैट इज एग्जांपल हियर. सो डू यू थिंक योर डेटा इज सिक्योर्ड व्हेन इट कम्स टू इंडस्ट्री 4.0? सो यू आस्क एनी स्टूडेंट, रैंडम स्टूडेंट इन एनी क्लास दिस क्वेश्चन, टेल मी व्हाट विल बी द आंसर.
Will be a no.
Okay. Entire population will say no.
Yeah.
Correct. Very few people, like 1 or 2% people will say yes. 98% will say no. Right. Therefore, this is no reflection happening here. Reflection has to be when you ask, how do you, what are the ways in which you can secure your data in Industry 4.0? Now, if I ask this question, what will be the answer? Will it be yes or no?
No, it will be answers.
What will base. Be your answer? Like, for example, what will be Richa Agarwal's answer? There will be some X methodology, right?
Yeah, methodology.
Dharna's answer will be some Y methodology. Dilip Kumar's answer will be some Z methodology. Samir's answer will be some ABC methodology, right? That is where it is called as reflection spot. Because it cannot have yes or no. Okay, it cannot be binary question answer, because it will just defeat the purpose of reflection. It will be merely something that people will not even a very good Urdu word for that. Zehmat bhi nahi uthayenge log answer karne ki. Theek hai? Kyunki unko koi they will not get anything out of it, right? I don't know. I could not get a better word at that point, but this is very appropriate word according to me. So they will not even bother to answer the question. If you ask such a question, they'll say, "Theek hai, sabko pata hai, it is not secure. Then why are you asking me?" It is not giving a pause. It is not giving a reflection idea. It is not giving a engagement break. People will just मतलब गाना सुनते सुनते आपका स्लाइड चला भी जाएगा, ऐसे हो सकता है. सो दैट इज अ वेरी हार्श एंड वेरी ब्लंट फीडबैक, बट द पॉइंट इज दैट वी नीड टू रीथिंक अबाउट द रिफ्लेक्शन स्पॉट आइडियाज इन अ बेटर वे इज माय सजेशन टू यू. बट रेस्ट ऑफ द थिंग्स आर वेरी वेल थॉट ऑफ. आई थिंक यू हैव टच बेस अपॉन नाइस एलबीडीज एंड नाइस आइडियाज अबाउट व्हाट ऑल कैन बी आस्क्ड टू पीपल. LBDs were nice, LXTs were nice. Video क्या होना चाहिए उसके लिए ऊपर लिखा हुआ था कि ये वीडियो में क्या दिखेगा आपको. Very nicely done that part. Your structure was nice. What you want to cover in the course and things like that. Your presentation was also nice. Like you did not open the entire script and you say script है उसमें हम लोग ये explain करने का ये पूछेंगे. यहाँ तक सब ठीक चल रहा था. The only thing which I think got slightly derailed was when the reflection spot question is not able to generate everything. Did you get the point with the example I provided?
Yes, yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay.
And what about the rest of the reflection spots? They are also having the same issue?
Now you tell me that. Okay, go ahead. Now you have.
This is again, yeah. Yes, yes. This is again you mentioned.
Yeah.
This also cannot be a reflection.
Exactly. Exactly.
Right. Got it.
Yes. Okay. Otherwise, yes. I think you have done a lot of hard work in getting the thing right. I think with some iterations and some more deliberation, I think you are almost there. Thank you.
Thank you,
sure.
So much. Thank you so much.
Yeah. We have Akhilesh. And who is the presenter after this?
Juhika from the School of Law, Juhika Group.
Ah, okay. So you will do the timekeeping, Juhika madam.
Oh, all right, sir.
Akhilesh, unmute yourself.
So you can go ahead.
Can you able to see my slide, sir?
Yes. This is kind of PowerPoint mode if you want to.
Is it okay, sir?
Fine.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. I am Dr. Akhilesh Latorya on behalf of School of IT, along with my colleague Mr. Abhijit Katare. We are going to present one of the topic which is the part of the MOOC course. MOOC course Introduction to Machine Learning. This is the introduction to machine learning. This is what we have divided, and what we have done here, we have done a different thing. We have put a logo of the checklist. This is a checklist of the objective of the MOOC, target audience and prerequisite. And what is the object of the MOOC is to provide learning platform.
Sir, we yes, cannot sir. See your slide. We can only see your, I think you have shared the, now we can see this.
Yep, I press the F5. Still is not able to see.
No. So the button you have shared, the screen you have shared is this one and not the F5 one. I think there are two screens on your laptop.
Is it okay? Fine, sir.
No. You have to. You have to share the window of the presentation window.
Wait,
out
sir,
of
wait.
The two windows, select the presentation window.
Now, sir?
Now it is correct.
Okay. May I start again? May I start again, sir?
No. Yeah, no problem. You can just skip the things. Okay. We have also seen the objective.
Okay. So this is our checklist. First is the objective of the MOOC. So what is the objective of the MOOC? Our introduction to machine learning is to provide a learning platform for all the enthusiasts and the curious fellow to learn the machine learning concept. And the second thing is the target audience. That is all natural intelligence means. All natural intelligence means all human being, even the layman can come and gain a knowledge from us. And what is a prerequisite? Prerequisite is here is what as of course is our course is very basic and need not to have expert in any field. Only thing is required for it is to have one of the wonderful tool to learn, that is our own calm and peaceful mind for or a great desire to learn the things. This is our prerequisite. And this is how we divided the contents in the week wise. And we going to cover our MOOC course in the span of 4 weeks. And in the week one, we going to introduce the machine learning with a real life example. And week two, we are to walk you through in the concept of Python programming. And week three is supervised learning. And week four, unsupervised learning is going to give you the in the week four. And here, what we have done, we have taken the week three supervised learning as a sample of the MOOC today's presentation.
Okay, very good.
So this is our week wise plan, or this is also called a blueprint. The week wise, we have included all three learning unit 8. Here we have covered the course introduction, other basic or supervised learning, and what is supervised learning, types of supervised learning, and what are the steps we will cover in the supervised learning. And on that basis, we have our MCQs and the weekly feedback. And we'll give in the video of live interaction along with the transcript.
Just one point here.
Yes,
that
sir.
This is a week in the course, right?
Yeah, sir.
Then why is your learning unit one called as course introduction?
Okay, sir. Okay, fine. Though I can put it over there, supervised learning introduction.
Introduction of supervised learning is fine. Yeah, okay. Great. Go ahead.
Okay, sir. Okay, so this is how we divided our flow of LED content. The first is example to understand. We have put it the two or three example over there so a student can learn by the live example. And the second is supervised learning, learning and then focus. Here we are giving the few definitions and other concept about the supervised learning. And again, we need to understand what is the machine learning first, because supervised learning, reinforcement learning, and unsupervised learning is the type of machine learning. And once you have understand what is supervised learning, in the fourth week, we are going to give the idea upon unsupervised learning. So we need to understand what is the difference between supervised learning versus unsupervised learning. Once we have done with the supervised learning versus unsupervised learning, so we'll have a focus on supervised learning process, which is divided into two types. And once we have this sixth, so we need to understand what is learning within the supervised learning and what are the fundamental assumptions of learning. So here the example, and this is why we need a problem statement. So a student can easily identify there. What we have done over there, student need to build a model, a classification model on the basis to predict a high risk patient and a low risk patient. Once they identify, the model will identify the high risk patient, it will be admitted into ICU, and the low risk patient won't. And another example we have, there's a credit card company receive thousands of lakh of application for a new card, and these are the fields on the basis they are giving the card approval or not approval. This is again a machine learning based model. This is the classification based model. And here, here's the one logo we put it over there at the top. This is a pin. This means, as we have discussed with you, sir, you were saying you have to put a smileys over there if there is an important slide. So we use this one. Okay. So what is understand the supervised learning? So we have mentioned with the pictorial representation as well. In this, we are explaining in the next slide. Okay. So you know the machine learning is all about to play with the data. So we have used here is a kind of CSV file or a data with a column, age has fields, own house, credit. On that basis, we have created a reflection spot over there. We have created reflection for within our slide. On that basis, student need to find out the particular loan is be approved or not. And again, because in the fourth week, we going to teach unsupervised learning. The student need to understand what is supervised learning and what is unsupervised learning and what is the difference between unsupervised learning. So this is how this is why we put it over there, this slide. And this again, this is a description of the previous one of this slide. And these are the steps, as we mentioned, of an LED within LED, because this is the whole summary of LED. And we have two parts, the learning and the testing. When first we used to train the data and testing the data. So this is how we have defining the steps of training the database and how to test the database or the model, sorry. And again, as we have mentioned over there with the LED, so this is what you mean by learning. The learning always have three parts: data, task, and performance. On that basis, we will create a LPD LXI. And then further will be discussed by Rajiv Katare, sir. Rajiv, sir, over to you. Katare, sir. Rajiv, sir.
Hello, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible.
Very good evening to everybody. So first of all, I thanks Dr. Samir and Dr. Rohit for providing this wonderful platform for providing us opportunity for learning most of the things, many things that we have incorporated in our this MOOC presentation. And besides of that, we have included here just like, since we are programmers, so obviously icons are required. So here, to get better feel of any slide, we used to put certain icons here so that we can easily understand what this particular slide is going to be tell us. So next is LBD, learning by doing things. And here we have put one question that is MCQ based, and it has four options. And based on that four options, we have given the feedback, the constructive feedback. Next slide, sir. Akhilesh, sir, next slide.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, so this is our customized and constructive feedback. So customized and why constructive? Because we have explained properly the reason why the option A is correct, why option B is incorrect, and similarly, why other options are incorrect. So this is our one thing. And next, sir. Okay, that LBD also include the apply level question. Apply level, since machine learning, we are going to teach the Python programming in our second week. So for that, obviously, we have to put certain things relates with the programming part. So that's why applicable apply level questions are also will be included here. So the question is, write down all the Python modules through which the machine learning algorithm can be implemented. So out of these, one or two or three or any number of option can maybe correct. Right. Yeah. So go ahead, sir. So here, option A is incorrect, as NumPy is this. Option B is correct, as it is used for machine learning. Option C is incorrect, and option D is also correct. So this is the customized feedback for the LBD. Next is our assimilation quiz. And yeah, we have carefully chosen the assimilation quiz along with the proper marks here. So that a student has certain interest to learn, to understand the concepts. So here, what do you know about population and sample? Actually, this is the main concept in machine learning. So that's why we have included this question. And obviously, these kind of concepts are not available in our complete MOOC. It is slightly beyond that. But yeah, obviously, it is important for machine learning. So that's why we have included this as a assimilation quiz, as LXT. So answer about question based on video link, and this answer is available on this video. Here is the link. and watch this video from this point to this point I have given, and as well as I have given title of the video also, that the particular title of the video is this.
And this is only the part one of the video.
Yeah, exactly. And this is the discussion related with the LXI. LXI, I remember once during the MOOC, I remember that, and I came to know that just by a particular mentor, everything is not going to be learned. So some peer learning is also essential and required. Yeah, that is the new thing we have learned. So that is, we have implemented in LXI. And here, for that purpose, we have created a certain kind of question which actually generates some thoughts related with the concept we have taught to the students, and the students will discuss among each other, and they will come to the particular particular answers after discussing the questions among each other. Yes, sir. Next. Okay, this is the solution. Solution, we also provide the solution of that particular discussion so that they can identify how close their answer is or how they are correct or incorrect, whatsoever it is.
As we are discussing this fixed slide, classification model.
Yeah. Next, sir. Okay, so one last is, obviously we love to get the feedback finally, how we did actually. So for that, I have taken one sample here, just. So that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on. And after getting the feedback, we came to know, okay, how was our course? And finally, thank you. And now we love
feedback,
from Samir sir for further.
Yeah, I would have loved to give feedback also in icons like you had used there.
So being an embedded programmer, we used to do that.
Yeah, it is. Nice idea actually that you had used. The only thing I have to comment on is the structure is good. Can you go to second slide? Yeah, this is fine. Because your text boxes were overflowing, we could not see some of the content in these slides. Slide number 2. So that was the problem, but because we could figure out that what you wanted to just say. Okay, let us go next. Maybe the fourth slide is important, sir. So this was quite nice, the way you had planned, whatever you want to talk about. I think you need to give more emphasis. You can build upon this by adding another row here, and you can say what approximate timing are you going to devote to this. Like if you are saying information video about supervised learning introduction, then what is the estimated timing that you are giving out for this particular thing? So it would be like 6 minutes, 8 minutes, 12 minutes, whatever, you have to just say that. Okay, that is one part, one thing we can add, because it's a nicely planned thing, very well planned. You want to start. So the learning unit one will, so instead of information video and documents, you can just talk in that same terms like you have used in the subsequent boxes. Like, is it going to be LED or is it going to be
LXI,
or LXI or whatever. So that you have to mention here. That is not written. Are you going to start with a discussion? Are you going to start with a video? Are you going to start with a activity or whatever? So that you have to mention here. Slide number 5. Yes, okay, so this was the outline of the LED. Now, if I think again the same problem was that LED is not thought as a 10-minute chunk. This is a mistake done by many other groups also. LED is thought as a week-wise whole thing. So I think this,
sir, may I? This is one of the LED. It could be LED 1, LED 2, LED 3 of the week 3. Because week 3, we have a supervised learning, regression, and decision tree. Here, we have taken only supervised learning topic. So, once we have the whole week 3.
What is the approximate timing of this LED? How much time will this take up?
2 hours, sir?
Yeah, that is quite much.
That is the problem. That is the problem. LED cannot be more than 12 minutes. So, actually, what you have written here is the entire week.
Yes, sir.
And the week will have multiple LEDs. So, what is understanding supervised learning is a LED of 15 minutes. Supervised versus unsupervised learning is another LED, which is another 15 minutes or 7 minutes or whatever time.
Okay,
that is what is missing in the design right now. The rest of the thing is all fine. I think you are the experts on the topic, so not a problem.
Okay, sir. So can so we can divide like key points in machine learning is could be LED 1 and LED 2 and LED 3, LED 4. So it could be LED 2. Okay.
Yes. Fine, and sir. Then you have to write the duration of that. Like this is going to be covered in 8 minutes.
In 5 minutes and 10 minutes.
Minutes okay. 10 minutes or whatever. Huh?
Okay, fine, sir.
That is required. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Good. Thank you. It was nice.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Let us have the presentation from the liberal arts team now.
Good evening, all. I request Ms. Veena to please, if she can present the screen, and I request Mr. Veg to please come on the screen and share what we have
done. Well, just 1 minute, I'm just doing it.
Yes.
So I hope this is visible. Jinika ma'am, is my screen visible?
Yes, it is visible. If you can just do the slideshow, it would be better.
Sure. Just doing that.
Perfect.
Okay, the whole screen is visible?
Is it moving? Yes.
Okay. So, good evening, everyone. We from School of Liberal Arts are going to present the sample MOOC presentation today. So, the title of the MOOC course would be Laws and Principles of Gestalt Theory, and we are the members. And thanks to Ms. Subarna from School of Law, she also helped us for a few things. That. So the objective of this MOOC is to introduce the fundamental laws and principles of Gestalt theory, because Gestalt theory nowadays is very much is being used in the principles of therapies and counseling, but still the basic fundamentals of perception are the one which was laid by the early pioneers. So we want to focus on that, and how can we use it, or how do we use it in the streams of designing, sketching, drawing, and media and all the other things. So the target audience for this course would be undergrad students and graduate students from any discipline. People from any discipline interested in this course can take it. School students, school teachers, and parents. Now, the blueprint for this would be, this would be a 4-week course with 60 minutes of lecture every week, and we'll be starting with the introduction, meaning then there will be definitions, what was the history of Gestalt theory, how and who were the pioneers of the field, what were the experiments they done with, what is the scope of the principles of the Gestalt theories, then with the feedback. Then moving on to the week 2, we'll be talking about, now we'll be coming to the laws and principles and the different laws of Gestalt theory, like law of closure, law of similarity, and all those different things. We'll be classifying them in how the artists use them, or how we are as human beings, how we are forced, whatever perception we have, how it is forced and how we see it. So of course there are many laws, so we have divided them into 2 parts. One will be different laws, part 1, then we'll be covering the rest of the laws in the upcoming part. Then what are the applications to? So 3rd week we'll be talking about the applications. As you can see, it is in the field of design, in the field of media, then in the field of integralism, because there's a very famous quote by there's a very famous principle of Gestalt is that the sum of the part is different from whole. Similarly, it means that if you see things in an integrated form as a whole, they are different by just some of its part. So we also use it in, we can also widely use it in the integral education and in the integral philosophy. Moving next would be the conclusion part. What are the limitations of this? What are the contemporary scenarios? What are the major influences and all? I would like to talk about the structure for the week first, which will be like this. The definitions, Cisco, which I've already told you, the materials we'll be using will be reading material. We'll be having some interactive dialogue, reflection thoughts, then moving next to the case study, visual quizzes, reading material, videos, and everything. I just want to keep it short and crisp, so I'm just cutting off the major part because I think we are running very short on time. So then the week second, week third, week fourth. Now, the LED for week one will be introduction to Gestalt theory. The breakpoints will be meaning of perception, what is perception, what are some biological processes included in perception, and how now coming to the history and applications of Gestalt principles. Then what are the meaning of Gestalt theory, definition, our LED flow of LED content will be from definition to the drawbacks. Definition, laws, applications, and drawbacks. Then the reflection spots and the script, the origin, application, scope, and everything. Now coming to the reflection spot, like we have some questions, write down or mention three logos based on any 2 points of Gestalt theory with the brief applications. Because many many brands use different sort of logos. For example, there in upcoming slides, I'll show you one or two logos. Then many movie posters. Then there are many illusions which we use as kids. We psychologists use for our this unconscious knowing the unconscious and other things. We use many different kind of images which are not cleared. Then logos of any other brand and creating a logo, how and what could be better in what, how can we create an effective logo. Then reflection spot second will be to writing down where and how can we apply this theory in our life. Because people, as I just told you, they'll be using it from anybody can access it. The course is open for everyone. So different people from the field of design, from the field of education, from the field of learning, anyone or everyone can take this course. So the script is studying a new topic, conceptualizing things to a large content, like the bottom-down approach, the top-down approach, and then moving next to how we can, there's a concept. Some people suggest to break down the concept and study it, but while using the Gestalt principles, how we can integrate and look at the bigger picture with that. Then the title will be for the week one, will be Laws and Principles. There are some understanding level questions, few questions which are objective kinds. Then some customized feedback, constructive questions, and why the answer is correct and why B is not correct, why it is correct. So it is self-explanatory why the other options are not correct. Then there is some application level question which the participants will be using in writing and sending to us. Other than that, we have included this constructive customized feedback, the limitation of the Gestalt theory, we have told it. And after that, there is an activity which they can see and apply. For example, this is a very famous movie posters from the Batman. And you can see, if you see it from this angle, you can see Batman clearly. But if you reverse this image, you will see the Penguin, which was the antagonist for this movie. So, and the FedEx logo also gives us a feeling of a truck moving in forward. So these are some clever ways in which people use this Gestalt principles. Now we have given some web links. There is a video of the Gestalt principle basics for beginners, so they can access this video. Then there are some documents and for the book for cognitive psychology, and the chapter is mentioned. Then there's a book on principle of Gestalt for the early starting psychologists who's worked on it. Then there are there's an assimilation quiz, the main point of focus in which a visual display is known as, so they can test their knowledge which they have learned till now. Then another little bit of visual hint cue question which is included. Thank you. This was the basics which we prepared.
Okay. Thank you, Meg. Actually, you tried to keep it very short, and I can see there were a lot many things that you wanted to speak, but for the want of time. Also, I wanted to hear, because this is some topic which is so close to my heart, being a fine arts graduate and a designer.
Exactly, we were scared, like you were saying all to other that I cannot comment on the subject expertise, but this was such a topic where you can also come in.
Writing is a slot for me, yes. So, but again, like I said, I am not going to comment about the content in any case, not just because it is in my domain. Rightly so, because entire plan of this workshop is all about understanding the design of a MOOC. It is not about how to teach a particular subject. Okay, so that is an individual decision, and I respect that, and that could be varied. Like when I teach Gestalt principles in my class and how you teach in your class could be different, and that should be okay. What is important here to understand is how we have structured the course. Is it valid for getting the expected engagement from the learners, those who are going to register for our course? Is that going to happen? That is what I am going to talk about. So if you can just share your screen once again, it will help me in pointing out some of the issues where we can modify. So if you look at the reflection spot one, where you said that the structure is all fine, the week-wise structure is looking nice. You had a go down probably. Reflection spot one, slide number 12. Yeah. So write down or mention three logos based on the Gestalt principles, right? That's the reflection spot. The question here could be because there are multiple things to be done. So if you recall the definition of what is a reflection spot, typically the first question is that is it based on the content that you have explained? So yes, it is based on the same thing. I assume that you have already explained the Gestalt principles by that time. So they would be able to figure out. But the question here will be, is it possible to answer this in a minute, 1 minute? Because people will not, reflection spot is happening within the video. So the video cannot end, stop endlessly. Like this will take easily 15 minutes for me to figure out three logos, then look at which laws are actually getting applied, and then give an explanation. I'm definitely going to outnumber the minutes of the LED itself. If LED is 15 minutes, my reflection spot is going for 15 minutes then. That is the problem with this. Instead, if you show two logos and say that, okay, or any logo, and you say which laws of Gestalt are applied in this logo, tell us. And especially choose an image which has multiple Gestalt laws implemented. That would be a nice reflection spot. I can solve it in 1 minute, and then you can continue with your lecture. That would be a change that I thought of suggesting. Do you agree with this?
Yes, sir, definitely.
Yeah. So that I think will be that will be interesting to for the learners to reflect upon, and they will feel very elated to answer this, because they will feel, wow, now I have got end of it. So that is where yes, so that is the option. I think
like we have done this slide.
What is that? I did not get it.
Is it visible to you, sir?
Yeah, you have edited the thing, right?
I think it's not visible. Wait. Like,
I saw which laws are implemented in this stuff. Yeah. So, what you can write is there as a reflection spot is show an image of a logo which has multiple Gestalt principles applied, and ask learners which laws are applied here.
Yes, sir. Got it, sir.
Okay, great. So, okay, I will just summarize in precisely 10 minutes whatever we have seen so far. But first of all, thank you very much for sportingly participating in this part, because this was kind of very new for all of you about thinking of a MOOC and then coming up with reflection spots and this and that. What I realize is that there has been misinterpretation of some of the nomenclature, which is very natural. Even we get this feedback every now and then that you have confused us so much about what is LED, LBD, LXT, LXI, reflection spot, assimilation quiz, knowledge quiz, reflection quiz, and all these things. It's very complex. So I totally get it that if you are not able to stick to the normal definitions of these things, it is quite possible. So not an issue on that, but I would strongly recommend that you have to in the points where I have given feedback that okay, LEDs of these people are very good, LXTs of these people are very good, LBDs of these people are very good, I think you should talk to these people and try to get more and more feedback about how you can develop your own thing. Because what I feel is that there is a common misconception across. Now, there could be exceptions, but overall, I saw that there is a common misconception which has happened in most of the presentations, is that the LED as a word has been taken as the entire week. That is one common thing which has happened across many presentations. So first of all, LED is not weak. Weak is a bunch of content, and bunch is really huge bunch because it will have videos, reading material, case studies, discussion forum activities. It could have additional reading material and whatnot. That entire thing is called as weak. But on the other hand, LED is only the video that is presented on the portal. So that is the first misconception. Second is that many of the LED scripts were written in the fashion that you are addressing a live audience. Like you have people in front of you and you are going to ask something, yes or no, poll questions. So that is not possible in an offline video because you will not have anybody in front of you that time when the video gets played. So that is not a good idea to imagine the video script when people are live. So imagine people offline and try to write the script in that format. That is one more thing. For that, my suggestion is going to be watch the videos again and again which we have posted in the VLE. Because we have tried to give you examples of all these things. So it's like these are exemplar videos. So maybe that will be useful for you to understand these concepts much better. That is the second point. The third point I thought was, at a very broad level, people have understood the LXTs quite nicely now. However, there are certain cases where LXTs still sound like what I said yesterday, outsourcing my teaching. So I have the same topic has been the label of the LXT. That if I talk about thermodynamics is the topic of my course, you will see the video also titled thermodynamics. So that is just simply outsourcing this. If I have a video which talks about application of thermodynamics in space or application of thermodynamics in agriculture, that would be a definitely additional reading material. So please remember this, LXT is not outsourcing your teaching. That is the third point. The fourth is about the placement of LBDs. Many a times the LBDs have been thought as a separate entity. In my opinion, always have a combination of the video and activity. So you have one video, attach one activity to it. So that would be the best option to have. Now that will definitely tell you whether the learners have got the point or they have not got the point. So this is where I think these four things are the takeaways for all of you, in my opinion. You can definitely build upon what you have started off with. Like we said, Rohit, sir, what is your comment about like what you saw today and what could be
kind of way ahead? That is what I have seen is that very rightly put across by you that the relationship between the different components, you know, with reference to the topics and what we are going to do in MOOCs. This is my personal observation, I may be wrong, but what I have seen is we have considered MOOC as if we are going into a classroom with some presentation, you know, apart from the presentation made by the group today, by what School of Law and Dr. HR group, you know, where they have very clearly mentioned what they're going to do. The biggest gap which I have seen is the link between the LBDs and LEDs, and then the reflection spot which we are putting up. Now, the reflection spot is not a question which I want to ask from the people concerned, but I really want to engage the audience into that process of learning. And this is where I felt that many people have missed that objective of reflection spot, number one. And number two is very rightly pointed out, but this is the common mistake we everyone, and the kind of referencing for the video link which we are putting up. So this is the common mistake we do when even we writing paper, we don't put the full title and say, okay, the link is from here. But normally the description of the title along with what is going to be in that video from where you have to see, that has to be specified, because otherwise the basic objective of creating an interest to see that video may be missed. And our objective is to keep them continuously engaged. So what I have seen, and the best part which I have find it out is that, okay, fine, it is my topic, then my reflection is paused, and then again my topic. That has been missed by many of us. That I agree. But yes, as you rightly said, this is the first time we are going into for the MOOC. So maybe next time we may be much, much better. And I'm going to say that this is not going to be the first MDP we are going to do with you. I believe once we finish it off, then people will discuss within the group. They will try to create the MOOCs for their programs also. And before finally going on and putting it for the outsiders to subscribe for the program, I think we need once again, you all again, to see what kind of preparation we have done before actually we go live with the outside people.
Right.
Yeah. So there
yes, I think... Yeah, I agree with so I think what overall I can see is that the takeaways are seen in bits and pieces in various presentations.
Yeah.
The problem I can see is that there needs to be a huge debrief meeting within yourself now to sit down and actually look at the comments that I have given. Probably many of you have, I saw that many of you made it a point that you just edited your slides immediately and added those. Couple of them may have written it down on something else. I saw somebody yesterday saying, Monica madam saying that I have 2 pages full of some comments for somebody's presentation and so on and so forth. But my suggestion would be, if you have a debrief meeting and figure out or make a list of things that have worked well in these presentations and the ones which need some modification.
Yeah, yeah. Point if of you make that list of gap, you know. Yeah. I'm saying improvisation and the gaps which we have identified from our presentation.
Yes. So I think if you concentrate on the best practices or the well done portions, that will give you a way into which
Richa ma'am, can you hear him?
Yeah, yes, sir.
I think he has lost his connection over.
Yeah, it seems so. Because his team members are there, I'm not sure.
Yeah, the team is here. I think he has lost the connectivity. He'll probably, yeah, he's back. Yeah,
yeah, sorry.
Yeah, sorry, I lost the internet in between.
Yeah.
But I think once you all do the debrief meeting about what has worked and what's not, I think that will give you a bigger insight. And you need to have a small team probably to have a consultancy with different MOOC creators on the specific component level. So there could be course design specialists, there could be LED specialists, there could be LBD specialists, and so on and so forth. We have the same thing in our domain here. So I think that will help out all of you. And second and the most important thing I can see is that whenever we, I don't know when will that happen, but if we are going to offer this MOOC on how to create MOOCs on Swayam this semester or the next semester, I would request all of you to take up that MOOC, because that would be a interesting thing to have, and that will enable you to interact with a larger group, because that is taken by more than 5,000 people in the country. So that will help in interaction and building up the expertise. These are the two takeaways, and I think you can make use of the VLE course as much as you can, because we have tried to really put a lot of hard work in constructing a course for you. It is almost replica of the course which is happening on Swayam. It is as good as the same course, and all the content is already been there. So video lectures, live sessions are also, I think Rohit sir has suggested, and people have already uploaded. I think your team has done a wonderful job of that. But going through the VLE content again and again will only ensure that the concepts are taken in a proper spirit. So I think that is my closing remarks for what we had today.
Yeah,
any other comments or feedback? Unless people are hungry and waiting for dinner.
Yeah, so if anybody is having a comment, they can give it. Otherwise, then we will ask Richa ma'am to formally place a vote of.
Samir sir, do we have a specialized video in making the MOOC, every component separately, like whatever we talked in all the MOOCs presentation today? Is there a specialized video on reflection spot? Is there a specialized video on, you know, the quiz? Or
it is. It is. You just go to VLE. We have done that part, right?
Okay, fine.
Yes.
So we can do from there. Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, so Richa ma'am, you can formally place a vote of thanks to Professor Samir and his team for the one-month follow-up and workshop with us.
Sure, sir. Once again, good evening to one and all present here. It's indeed my privilege to propose a vote of thanks as we conclude the FDP today. I'm sure all of us will wholeheartedly agree that this FDP has been a great learning experience, and to achieve a new milestone in our teaching careers, that is preparing a MOOCs. Somewhere almost all of us have been looking forward to create the MOOCs on our own, especially in last 1.5 years, 2 years, or even before that. Some of us even tried to look for guidance towards preparing the FDPs. As you know, we can understand now that MOOC instructors need a set of design principles, guidelines to create a learner-centric MOOC. And then there came a message from Rohit sir about this 5-week workshop or FDP on creating the MOOCs. So basically, through this workshop, we learned about the learner-centric model, its applications to create the effective MOOC. Discussions during the sessions were really very interactive, sir. And the live examples of reflection spots, though we made a lot of mistakes, even we made a mistake on that, LXTs, LBDs, etc. So all of them actually were the live examples where we could understand that where we should place them. And definitely we need a lot of practice right now. And I'm sure we all will improvise on that in very near future. So, sir, on behalf of Oro University and all the schools of Oro University, I would like to express my gratitude to you, Professor Sameer Sahasrabudde, sir, and your team, Ajita ji, Ambili, Ila Vinil, Daisy ji, Tejinder ji, and all others who have patiently attended to so many queries we had from all of us. I would also like to thank Honorable Vice Chancellor of Aarhus University, Professor Rajan Velukar, sir, for providing us this opportunity to learn how to prepare the MOOCs. Definitely, I would like to thank Dean Dr. Rohit Singh, sir, for his ever-extending support during the workshops, be it timing-related or any other concerns we had at times during the workshops for the last 5 weeks. And last but not the least, I would like to thank all my faculty colleagues who have attended the FTP with so much enthusiasm and who have actively participated in the exercises given to us during these 5 weeks, especially during the last 2 days where we all participated, presented, smiled together. So that was really great. So I once again extend my heartfelt gratitude to all the facilitators, my management, our management, and all my colleagues. Thank you so much.
Yeah, just one person who is behind the scenes, but has not never been on screen and helped us into this technicality. This is Sumit Katekar from my department of educational media, who has really kept the VLE site up to date. And of course, thank you, participants, because without that, it was not possible.
Just to add over here, I and my colleague Neha, we are also participating into the Commonwealth OE for open education platform for the learners. Just for the information of all the faculty members, Ajita Deshmukh ma'am is taking care over for the MOOCs, learner centering MOOCs for us.
So that is wonderful. I think it's happening in October now.
October, yes.
So that would be nice to see you all there.